those of you who may not know me, my name is Mary Roberts. I have the distinct pleasure of serving as the Executive Director of Frank Lloyd Wright's Martin House, and I welcome you here this evening to the Eleanor and Wilson Greatbatch Pavilion. We are very honored to host this evening's presentation by Mr. Ken Tadashi Oshima, who will be introduced in just a moment by Martin House curator Susanna Tapata. The celebration of Frank Lloyd Wright's 150th anniversary, I'm getting my cues, and this is where I'm because our student will have the same issue. it's a delicate balance. many of you noticed that the celebration of the 150th anniversary of Frank Lloyd Wright's birth was recognized this past June 8th. We honored here Wright's legacy here at the Martin House. We did it in collaboration with regional partners, the Greatbatch Conservancy. And we did it nationally with folks from the Frank Lloyd Wright Foundation, the Museum of Modern Art in New York City, and elsewhere. And it's especially timely and appropriate as we honor Wright's 150th anniversary as we celebrate the conclusion of the major restoration of the Martin House here in Buffalo. This evening's presentation is the second in a five-part series, and I hope that you'll all come back and join us again on August 4th when Michael Desmond will be speaking, and again on September 8th with Mabel Wilson, and October 6th with Jennifer Gray and Teresa O'Malley. And we can coordinate this. Are you going to say anything about the lecture series?
No, I'm not. Okay,
maybe just a little bit. Last time, we tried to coordinate and we still overlapped a little bit. This is a great lecture series that we're doing. It's something that is in conjunction with the Museum of Modern Art's retrospective that opened up just around the anniversary entitled Frank Lloyd Wright 150, Unpacking the Archive. That exhibition is open through October at the Museum of Modern Art, and I would encourage any of you to go see it. It's an incredibly rich, dense experience with a dozen different sections, different curators, inviting new scholarship on Frank Lloyd Wright, looking at his work through the eyes of the collections that were accessioned by MoMA and the Avery Architectural Library at Columbia University from the Frank Lloyd Wright Foundation. And so the Martin House is well represented there, among other things. And our series of lectures this year includes six of the curators from the exhibition. Barry Bergdahl, the main curator, opened the exhibition series, or our lecture series, just before the museum exhibit opened. I would encourage you all, if you have time, to go to New York and visit the exhibit before it closes in October. This is actually the catalog from the exhibition, and we actually shamelessly do have copies on sale. And if you're very nice, can they sign your copy afterwards if you'd like one? And they're at the front desk if you'd like that. I'd also like to mention briefly that tonight's lecture is sponsored. The Wright at 150 entire lecture series, I should say, has been generously sponsored by a number of individuals, including Bob Skirker, Sarah Skirker, and Sylvia and Paul Topias. And if you'd please join me in a round of applause, thank you. Dean of the School of Architecture and Planning, Robert Shipley, is here with us this evening, and we appreciate UV's support on so many levels at the Martin House, including the lectures videotaping this evening. So thank you, Bob, thank you, Mary, and thank you to the University of Buffalo. And I'm going to turn the speaker over to our Martin House curator, Susanna Tahan, who will introduce our guest speaker.
Good evening, and thank you all so much for coming here tonight. It's a pleasure to welcome all of you to the Martin House and to be part of the second lecture in our 150th lecture series. The series, I think, is a real unique opportunity for our community to come together, to listen, and to learn from some of the leading thinkers in architecture and design. Their presentations are also not only speaking about Wright, his career, but they're also placing it in context within the Martin House. And so I've been told from our speaker this evening, he's also including a lot of research and images that you won't get to even see at the MoMA exhibition. So we're seeing things in Buffalo that they won't be seeing in New York City. Tonight's guest speaker is Ken Tadashi Oshima. He is professor in the Department of Architecture at the University of University of Washington, where he teaches in the areas of transnational architectural history, theory, representation, and design. He has also held teaching positions as a visiting professor at the Harvard Graduate School of Design, and he's also taught at Columbia University and the University of British Columbia. In addition to his role as an educator, Dr. Oshima is an equally accomplished researcher and scholar. He's the author of numerous publications. I'll name just a few. Kiyonari Kikutake, Between Land and Sea, Architecturalized Asia, Global Ends Towards the Beginning, International Architecture in Interwar Japan, Constructing Kokusai Kenchiku, and Arata Isozaki. Dr. Oshima is also a curator. He's curated Tectonic Visions Between Land and Sea, works of Kiyonari Kikutake at Harvard Graduate School of Design, Sana Beyond Borders at the Henry Art Gallery. He was also co-curator of Crafting a Modern World, the Architecture and Design of Antonin and Noemi Raymond, which was a traveling exhibition. As I mentioned, and so did Mary, he is also one of the guest curators of the Museum of Art's Frank Lloyd Wright at 150 Unpacking the Archive, as well as a contributor to the corresponding catalog. Some of you may know that Dr. Oshima also currently serves as the president of the Society of Architectural Historians, and he's been an editor and contributor to Architecture and Urbanism for more than 10 years, co-authoring a two-volume special issue, Visions of the Real, Modern Houses in the 20th Century. And his articles on the international context of architecture and urbanism in Japan have been published in various journals and publications. In tonight's presentation, Dr. Oshima will explore the dynamic dialogue between East and West in Wright's work before and after the Martin House Commission. From the 1893 World Columbians Exposition, his first 1905 trip to Japan, and the decade-long design development of the Imperial Hotel and beyond. So think about the Martin House and the time that this house was built, and Wright's thinking about Japan and the influences before and after. After his presentation, he will take questions and answers, so I hope you'll engage in conversation with him. It's just a real treasure and treat to have him here today. So please join me now in extending a warm Martin House welcome to Dr. Oshima.
Younger, older, but that passion would not die. And also, the the difference between seeing it just in a print versus traveling and practicing and synthesizing it over the course of his career. And so, when we look at, also, how many of you have seen the exhibition in New York already? So if you want a preview, there are YouTube videos of all the curators talking about their objects and so forth. And so it's actually on the MoMA website. And that's one thing that will take a little bit of time to see.
So what do you talk about in your
talk? So I did talk about my object, which is this book. No, we'll talk about that. That is of the Imperial Hotel. It is published just after the 1923 Great Cultural Earthquake. And so it depicts the completed hotel. And maybe while we're waiting for this, I'll give you a little bit of tidbits on this. You know, the Imperial Hotel is, to date, Franklin Wright's biggest project. It's, you know, he spends 2 years over there, going back and forth, and 10 years for the whole design process. But this book is amazing because it shows a completed project, and it actually, I'll show you, has his sketches in it, and it's how he saw the completed hotel, because he returned to the United States in 1922 before the earthquake, before it was completed. And so that becomes a kind of window onto this design that we can see in this object. It'll make more sense when we see the actual images, we can talk about it, but it's a little preview.
Is it apocryphal, or is it true that the hotel virtually opened, like, just at the time of the earthquake?
On the day of the earthquake, but, you know, it's, as its official opening, it had a soft opening, I think, before then, but, and in his autobiography, he talks about how it was damaged, and how it was the brilliance of his design, and it's not all true. I won't tell you everything, but it is a very innovative structure, and it does have some damage, but one thing that is actually very interesting, although electricity is not our friend here, it's what saved the Imperial Hotel, because it was one of the first electrified hotels. And while the rest of Tokyo was burning with gas fires, that's what saved it. But it also was very expensive and problematic in terms of getting equipment and so forth, so there were problems with the client and not the best relations and so forth. So that actually is interesting to explore historically.
I have took the opportunity to read your essay in the catalog.
Oh, great.
And I couldn't help but notice that you suggested some Japanese sources for the Peacock Room in the hotel. Mm-hmm. Temples in Nagoya, as opposed to another scholar's Western model, and the same thing with the other thing. But I guess what I wanted to ask you was, you know, we do tend to view everything through Western eyes. It's this idea of transatlantic, it's almost like now we have to do both when it comes to another artist's involvement with another country. And I just wondered if you could speak briefly to what your principles are, or what your
views are. That will be my
Can you give us one hint?
But it's a great lead into what I'll discuss. The duality of looking at it from both sides.
Yes.
You know, there are certainly, I would say, Japanese sources and Western sources, Mesoamerican sources,
right.
How he's bringing it together. And there's almost an ambiguity that, and in the abstraction, that we can read into it in many different ways.
Mm-hmm.
And so, not only the Peacock Room, but really the overall
hotel
composition of that,
yes.
Which one could almost see if one squints the Martin House in a much larger scale of how the rooms are composed.
Well, what brought you to this? Maybe that's a more general question. What brought you to looking at this in
the
these two different ways?
Imperial Hotel, or it really does come from looking at, I mean,
well, you have knowledge of Japanese architecture.
How it's been discussed in English among writing scholars, but also how Japanese architects have been discussing it. That is actually quite different. I mean, so from the other side, from the Japanese side, it might seem very Western, and from the Western side, it might seem very Japanese.
Right.
And how that works.
Can you tell us how Wright got the commission to do the Imperial Hotel?
That's a very good question. It's a very complicated one in that there is actually another architect, a Japanese architect from who's in Chicago, who was originally commissioned, and then they do ask right after that. Wright is, I think, very proactive. He knows about this big project and has been to Japan in 1905. And so the dating is actually quite ambiguous as to how much he really pushed for it early on and how much he was then officially asked at a later date. So they want to have a Western architect, but one who is very prominent. But at this point in 1913 or so, he's not the world famous architect of the Guggenheim. He has very significant residential projects, and he's being published in Europe, but he's not quite the global architect that we know him now. And so he really did push. So that was a preview of what's coming. And so hopefully it'll make a little more sense with some of the images. And
you use the microphone.
Okay, thank you. I will use the microphone.
Yes.
Okay.
Technology.
Yes, we'll use technology, and hopefully expand on what I was explaining about all these scandals and issues, but the multiplicity of Wright's relationship to Japan. And so this is the image I wanted to show you of his display of works in 1914 at the Art Institute of Chicago. And here we do see actually some of the first drawings of the Imperial Hotel that are on display, but we also see his prints. So I guess this is not really work. I'll point. The prints here in his stands. I'm not sure if you think this is the Martin House. It's at least kind of akin to the design. But so this is his whole world that he's displaying at this moment, and how these prints, his interest in Japan, are all coming together. And so this is a kind of background for, as we're discussing, my contribution to the Museum of Modern Art. Exposition, Unpacking the Archive, starting with an object and what that story is that unfolds from that. So this here above me is the book. It is in Japanese on the title, so it's Teikoku Hotel, the Japanese. And actually, hopefully, this is hard to see in this image, but you'll see the power lines that were in front of the hotel, and that is very interesting in this story about the electrification of the hotel that really saved it. And so how this provides a much more complete view of the completed hotel, to understand the full experience of the hotel, but also its relationship to Frank Lloyd Wright over the course of his career, since, as I mentioned, he wouldn't return to Japan after 1922, which is a whole other story I think I'll go into a little bit later. But the Imperial Hotel, as those of you who have visited knows, it was a huge complex in the center of Tokyo, right adjacent to the Imperial Palace, and one that's very different from what was rebuilt at Meiji Mura, out in the pastoral theme park, architectural park, that does preserve the lobby, but not really that context and that scale. And so part of this unpacking is to provide a bigger picture of that. But also, the Imperial Hotel has often been seen as a kind of cul-de-sac of Wright's career, at least by some, or a kind of just footnote. And how does this fit into the career of, with the Martin House, and later on with Falling Water, et cetera, et cetera? So these are questions that I seek to discuss this evening. And one that, if you went to the hotel and saw this brochure, you would see that the Jewel of the Orient is here, is described as neither east nor west, but a hybrid combination of the two. And so, again, how these multiple layers work as we interpret the hotel. So the hotel has been seen in many different ways through pamphlets. Here the Japanese one, there's the Western one here. But it's interesting to see on the English one, it has Mount Fuji in the background. That's actually a construction because we've never seen Mount Fuji in that direction. As you want to see the hotel. But then the Japanese one sees it more as this Western hotel, perhaps, because it is where it hosts Western visitors on beds, and very different from the Gyokan on tatami mats, etc. So, as I mentioned, for example, Neil Levine, the great Wright scholar, does discuss this connection of how the pyramidal roofs do evoke Mount Fuji. And so, whether you agree with him or you think otherwise, we'll discuss today. But to bring it back to the Martin House and this dialogue early on, so before the Imperial Hotel project, we do see here prints, we see here the lobby space of the Martin House. There is certainly a connection in terms of the moldings in Japanese domestic space above the doors, sliding door openings, and the transom space above that that we can see in the Martin House. Obviously, proportions are different, but that way of the wood framing of the space, we can certainly see. And how Frank Lloyd Wright is very interested in these prints, how that's composed, how it really does frame the activities inside, but also the landscape outside. And so how that is playing a part in this work from early on. But also to contextualize this relationship to Japan, when we look at it from the 19th century to the 20th century, it has gone through a tremendous shift. Japan in 1860 had not officially opened to the West to establish diplomatic relations. And so here we see in Harper's Weekly the Japanese diplomatic mission with their chomage hair and their hakama, very different from the tail and coattails and the leather patterned shoes of the Western or American diplomatic mission. And so how different they were at that moment, or how little understanding perhaps there was back and forth. Just at this period when Wright is born. Also, the great exhibitions were the way that you would see far off distant lands. So the Great London Exposition of 1851, having objects from Japan juxtaposed with Siam, music, it's perhaps ambiguous as to where objects are from and this context, but there's a fascination with this form and how that becomes the vogue of the moment, at least here in these exhibitions. So whether it be in London or in Vienna, how we have not only vases and textiles, but actual dwellings here, but used in very different ways, whether this is actually a shrine structure or a dwelling. If it were a shrine, it would be sacred and you wouldn't walk around up the stairs, but it's all in this frolic and how that is experienced at that moment. So when we look at Frank Lloyd Wright in his early career, we do see a very different Wright, I would argue. When he's with Sullivan, especially for the Trani Persky House, where the Society of Architecture Historians is based, 1892, we have a very strong sense of symmetry, strong masonry, appearance on the facade. You know, we do see elements that will continue on, especially inside, but this is the context in which he's starting out. But the 1893 World Columbian Exposition in Chicago is a remarkable event and one that has a very big influence on Frank Lloyd Wright. Not only here with the rebuilding of the Hoden, the Phoenix Hall, and how that is, as we see, a distinctly different architecture from the white state behind. It's still symmetrical, as we see, but it's integrated with this landscape, and in the inside, we see a whole different world, two tea ceremony utensils, the screens, the man in the kimono, and how that would have made a strong impression in addition to these prints that are circulated widely. So here we see this composition, the symmetrical way that it extends out with these corridors. We see a corridor here, how that extends the space and can be translated in different ways.
Did Wright design that?
No, this here is a reconstruction of Phoenix Hall. He saw this, but he did not design it.
Okay. Do you know who did?
So this is a reconstruction by the government architects, but it's based on a historical model. And so it's actually the carpenters who are really constructing this. So, but in terms of this symmetry, it's interesting. Certain scholars, Kevin Duke, has looked at this relationship between Japan and Frank Lloyd Wright's career. And when we look at the plan, this symmetrical composition with the T Kinsky, of the Byodo-in, and others we can see all the way to the Martin House. And so how that could be seen to have strong affinities, whether it's directly influences a whole other point of discussion. But I do think it's very interesting to see this evolution of ideas. When we look at what was actually displayed, the black and white photographs really don't do justice to how opulent that would have been at the time. So just recently, last year, they discovered some of the panels in the Parks Department in Chicago. And so we weren't able to display this in New York, but they were very large. You have the gold leaf, like we have the gold leaf here in the house. That would sparkle in the interior. And so we do also see a peacock. So that will be an interesting motif also that will continue in the Imperial Hotel. But you know, it is designed for the Western audience. Here it's export ware. It's not just a display within the country. And so these are objects and pavilions designed to impress. So the gold leaf here, these vases are actually very tall and very different from what you might see today. And with a certain Victorian eye. There are many other architects who are interested in Japanese architecture, obviously Japanese art as well, but perhaps most interestingly is Ralph Adams Crown, the Gothic collegiate architect. And here he's writing about the impressions of Japanese architecture. So he's very interested in these pagodas and temples. But it becomes very interesting to see in relationship to what he designs. So there is a kind of quality of the wooden tracery and tectonic assembly of that in his stone Gothic construction. And so there is definitely a certain eye that's looking to a particular architecture in Japan and the subjectivity of that. So it's in this context of looking to Japan that there is a dialogue, how the West is looking to Japan, but then also Japan is looking to the West and trying to modernize, establish its legitimacy. So in 1868, it is officially open to the West in the Meiji period, building in Western idioms. One of the most famous is the Nokomeikan, which we see here, designed by British architect Josiah Condor, and a palace to dress up in Western attire, have a Western party, and have accommodations. So in some ways, this does become the precursor to the Imperial Hotel, which I'll go into is very interesting. But also these Western banks, and that as a symbol of legitimacy. So in contrast to that, for example, Crown is proposing this for the Japanese Parliament building with the pagoda roofs. So rather than the neoclassical style that the Japanese architects and clients are longing for, this is what he is saying is appropriate. So this is all to contextualize what we see with Wright. Also, James Whistler, very interested in Japanese art, as we see here with the screens. And obviously, there's a translation of his ideas and inspirations in oil. So, the difference between a screen painting with gold leaf and with ink to oil. But so again, this is part of this dialogue. Or here we see with Van Gogh, his interpretation of the woodblock prints, the famous bridge over the Sumida River with the rain obviously in oil it takes on a very different character, and actually the characters on the frame are not really characters, they're just kind of pictograms of random sorts, but it is, I think, interesting in seeing how he is looking at this art. And there's a way it's visual, there's a way that he's making it his own. So again, it's in this context that perhaps we can start to see Frank Lloyd Wright's own interest and take on prints and the culture of Japan during the 19th century leading to the 20th century. So there are other artists here looking at these prints as we see, but it's in this transformation that we start to see how Wright himself is depicting his own work. We do have the Japanese print in the middle, and then here we have the secessionist inclusion of that in their poster in Vienna. Then Klimt designing this poster, inspired by that composition of the curvy line and the long, tall, vertical format. Then further on, we can see Frank Lloyd Wright's own depiction of Willett's house. And so how that composition is literally framed by this interest in the Japanese prints, but abstracted in his own way. And so when we start to see it in comparison to the Vietnamese secessionists, there's definitely a way that they're not copying, but they're articulating it in new translations. So a particular interest, I think, is Frank Lloyd Wright's photography that is on display at the Museum of Modern Art's exhibition now. Here, photographing weeds, obviously with a very blank background to evoke the ink painting, having that vertical format, and then again framing it here with the line and the mark that looks like a Japanese stamp. So here it's very interesting that this is actually for House Beautiful, and so it's not for a Japanese art exhibition, but he's translating these ideas. There's the Midwest depicted in this new idiom that's all part of his creative process. Or even this other photograph, how in the black and white, again, it can evoke the qualities of Japanese ink painting. So this is all before he goes to Japan. So he's seeing Japan through prints, through objects, through other people. But in 1905, he does travel to Japan for 2 months. So this is very interesting in relationship to the Martin House, that you know, the design is completed, it is not open, or it's not, the Martins aren't living in the house yet, but how he experiences landscapes, how he sees a number of different structures that are in context and that are of a very different scale than perhaps what he saw in the United States. So it is very interesting to see his photo album, to see what he actually saw and what he took. Just to give you a sampling, here's a shrine, the Inquisition in Kobe. When we compare it to his design of the Romy House, I think it does become interesting to see that eye and how this horizontal roof of the shrine is recalled in the Romy House, that horizontality floating above the prairie. Obviously not a direct replica of the shrine, but ways, again, in which it resonates and becomes ways to think about a new composition for his architecture. Obviously, it's one that had been developing with the Martin House and perhaps extended even further in this context. So this resonance and wonder. But there are many different structures that he sees. He goes to the Korakuen Garden in Okayama that is one of the great gardens. And it's very interesting if you go there. I've led people there on tours. And here you have, for example, this pavilion with a stream that runs through it. And you know, it's very unique to have that little creek going right through. You might know where this is leading if you are a light fan. It's very interesting to think about in relationship to falling water, in that here you have a pavilion that's framing the landscape and has water running right through it. But when you are sitting on this platform here, you're actually not seeing the water. You're hearing the water, you're smelling the water, but how that could be translated later on into falling water, where again, you're not directly seeing the water when you're on the platform, you're hearing it, you're smelling it, so that experience becomes central to his design. So, in looking at this dialogue back and forth, he is collecting a lot of prints in Japan, and he's dealing with them, obviously. He's selling some to the Martins, and it is actually making a lot of money for him. And he has this exhibition first in 1908. And in connecting this interest with print, with his architecture, the whole installation, I think, does become very interesting. And how it's not only the print, but it's the stand, it's here, how the bonsai is on top of that, where you sit, how you see that, how it's hung, to create a whole space to appreciate the print. And so that this print here with the waterfall is not simply that print. Here in this print stand, it's absolutely integrated into the wood frame, and here, like having a vase, so that it becomes a whole composition, integrating architecture, art, and furnishings. So we'll see in a lot of his designs this fascination with the print and creating these rooms. Some of this really can't see in the Martin House, but this is a print gallery that was only existed for a short while, but in the Fine Arts Building, reconfiguring that to create these rooms, to appreciate the prints, designing not only the stands, but the furnishings. And so I find this chair that was designed for the Mori Print Gallery quite remarkable. In its abstraction, you know, this square, this predates the Dutch style designers, actually. And so he's definitely connected to Japan, but also very much a pioneer in connecting to other traditions and movements in Europe. So, we can see this perhaps most clearly here in the Spalding Gallery that he designs from Boston, where you have these chairs, you have the prints. These stands create this whole space for appreciating those prints, and then it's a room, so it's a room within a room. But in this sectional drawing, you can see very clearly how he's thinking about this whole experience, how you sit, how you look, that whole way you would experience it. So this is all percolating. As I mentioned, the whole commission to design the Imperial Hotel is on his radar. Hayashi Aisaku, who's the general manager, does officially visit Taliesin in 1916 to officially give him the commission, but he's been working on it for a number of years before that. And so the whole evolution of the design itself, I think, becomes very interesting. So here, this is washed out so you can't really read it, but we see how much time he was spending in Japan. In 1905, he's spending about 2 months. Starting in 1913, he visits 1917, 1919, 1920, 21, 22. So this period is about 2 whole years that he is in Japan. And so all of these different trips, he's seen a number of different seasons and working directly with the carpenters. So how this would all impact his design and his thinking was of central interest of mine in looking at the archive in Columbia. He's also going to MoMA Cheney. I mean, you know, he is escaping the tragedy of Taliesin and all the scandals, as many of you know. But how that opportunity to design this hotel of this scale is truly remarkable for Wright. And here how it's not only these wings of the rooms, but we see the terraces that look onto the multiple gardens. It's a whole city within a city with the banqueting hall, a movie theater, stores, etc. But you probably know, if you are a Wright scholar or enthusiast, it does come at the time of the Midway Gardens. And so it has a similar composition, symmetrical composition, the courtyard in between. And one that I had always thought was kind of the precursor to the Imperial Hotel, so Chicago up to Tokyo. But actually looking at the archives and looking more carefully at the dating, it's actually the Imperial Hotel that he's first exploring, and then he's developing the Midway Gardens. Midway Gardens gets built first. It gets destroyed in 1929, partially due to prohibition, and so we don't really know it firsthand. How the East comes to West instead of West goes to East, in this case, is an underlying current that I find with the project. But you know, when you look at models of it, here the Midway Gardens, it's, in terms of the architectural language, quite similar. The overhanging canopies, the terraces, again, as I mentioned, the symmetrical composition, one might really confuse one with the other. But there are distinct differences. There are sprites, these sculptural figures that were central to the Midway Gardens, that are consciously made Japanese in the Imperial Hotel. So this is the samurai sprite. That's actually labeled that, and so how that translation works out. But then they are in the terraces in between, essentially beer gardens. So people are enjoying the outside. Your beer gardens are actually very popular in Japan. So there is that commonality. Here we see one of the first sketches of the Imperial early on of how this is a courtyard. We could see, if we look at it carefully, perhaps the composition all the way going back to the Phoenix Hall of Yodoi in Chicago, the central structure of the pavilion extending out, but then how this again gets developed in many different ways. This is another early scheme with a more pyramidal roof. It's more of a ziggurat roof. That's hard to see. It becomes very interesting because, although that scheme is not realized, it is very reminiscent in the Diet building that would have this similar type of roof and consciously designed to not be east or west and not be that same type of orientalist pagoda that Graham had designed for Japan. But you might say, no, it's more Mesoamerican or in that stepped pyramidal form. And so how he is bringing these forms together here on this site. So here we have a photograph of the building site, and you do see it's huge. It is looking out into this park. The Diet building would actually be just on the other side of the park. And so that would have a very interesting relationship. And as I mentioned, the Imperial Palace is just here to the side. But other iterations of this design, you know, it is evolving over the course of 10 years, become much more Japanese. So with these pagoda roofs, on top of the elevator towers, and here, so these upturned roofs, the spire, the tops there, do become akin to some of the temples and shrines that he's taking interest in. The, here, the Shihongan-ji temple, actually in Nagoya, a photograph from the Wright Archive. So how he is seeing these elements and incorporating them into at least these schemes. You know, it's quite impressive to see this with the wings and how large that is. This isn't the final scheme, but we do see how it's evolving. Here it is stepping up. It is like mountain climbing to the peacock room at the top, but how all of those terraces work and create that dynamic experience. As we see here, coming to a more completed version of this in the drawings. But while we might see it much more Japanese in terms of these upturned roofs, when we see the plan here, this is the banqueting room, it has a crucifix form. So whether it's more like a cathedral, or you know, there is more of the crucifix plan here in the Martin House. And so again, there's ambiguity in this. And you know, one that's very minutely drawn. So these drawings were drawn in Taliesin in Wisconsin on huge sheets of linen, then transported to Japan. But it's very interesting, these are in feet and inches. And when you look, you know, they're very precise, actually, down to 1/64th of an inch, whether they could actually build that. But on site, there were many Japanese carpenters, and this dialogue back and forth, those of you who know in Japan, the traditional measure is shaku and sun. It's also about a foot. It's based on a human anthropomorphic size, but it's divided into 10 units instead of 12 units. So there's a lot of translation back and forth that goes on site when you look at the drawings, how Wright would present these drawings, how carpenters would come back with other drawings, and how that dialogue is what is actually built, as we see in the process. Just to give you a little bit more background of Wright here on site, he is living at large. This is his penthouse apartment that looks onto that site that we see here. So he has his screens, actually to the side is a grand piano, And he is kind of in his throne, and it's all being constructed. Actually, we weren't able to bring this to New York, but this is the plaster model that was made for the display of the hotel before it was constructed. It's very intricate, and so you really see his more developed ideas into composition, how the courtyard works, as well as the way this framing of light coming through the pergola would really bring it to life, as we see here. So again, this is captured in this book. When you flip through it, you can see all different angles. So there is a plan, but there are orange numbers with arrows, so it shows you where each photograph is taken. So you can kind of get this virtual tour through where what is, and especially since the hotel doesn't exist and the surrounding context has changed so much, it becomes this very important document. As I mentioned, you can see, actually hear better, those power lines that save the hotel. Here, we can see the Japanese interpretation, Keikoku-Koteru. Frankly, Wright, R-W-R-G-H-I-T. So there's lots of spelling. But you know, it's going back and forth. You can also see here Wright's own sketches. So he's constantly thinking about what he's seen, how to change it, how to enhance it. Some more sketches of from the book. But I find actually most interesting are these photographs that are colored and drawn. So these plants are drawn on top of the photograph. And so it's as he wanted it to be, not as it was actually photographed. And so when you go to the exhibition, you'll see some other photographs that, actually in just a second I'll show you, also indicates how he's drawing on these photographs to add the plants and make it better. So also in the Imperial Hotel, there are very few pictures. There are many of the peacock room, the dining room, the lobby, but very few of the actual bedrooms. And so here we start to see what some of these bedrooms were and how, again, it's the combination of the lighting, the chairs, and the whole living space that make this a very cosmopolitan site. Here actually are some of the photographs that are from the archive, and these aren't necessarily touched up, but what's, again, I think remarkable is we see how Frank Lloyd Wright is wanting us to see the hotel. So with this very vertical frame, enhancing whether it be the sculpture, landscape, and architectural composition all coming together in a very particular way. That frame that we saw from early on from the print continues here. Or here, a view of the courtyard with snow and climate change, and we don't see snow very much in Tokyo anymore, but becomes very interesting, I think, in relationship to this interest with prints. And so how he's creating these scenes that are depicted in the Japanese prints that he's collected. But again, bringing it to life. So when we see these photographs in relationship to actual textiles from the hotel, with these brilliant orange silk fabrics, we can start to imagine what that experience would have been. Or here with the chairs. I understand there's one of the chairs here in Buffalo, somewhere in the archives, I think, as well as I am told that one of the windows from the Imperial Hotel. But again, it's a whole work of art, the China, and how that comes together. So in the colorized photographs, you can find some of them online and postcards, but here we can start to see, again, what this whole space was, where it was a meeting of people from Japan, from the West, Marilyn Monroe, many other, Babe Ruth, apparently visited, and would have this social interaction in these spaces. So these hotels do become very important in that way. It's not only a place where you'd sleep, but where you would have a whole social encounter. Here is one more picture of the bedroom space. But these courts and the dialogue even further with the Japanese garden that we see here, that's in distinct contrast to the more stylized pool in front. But these are massive elements. The urn here from the hotel is one that you can see at the Metropolitan Museum in New York. It's adjacent to the Franklin Wright Room. I'm trying to get that into the exhibition, but it was too expensive to move and too heavy. But I do encourage you to see it, because you can see how the character of this Oya stone that Wright found really shaped the character of the hotel. So although we have brick here, brick in the size of the country did not do well, and this pumice stone that's lighter in weight that had previously been really used for paving on the street was reimagined by Wright to be central to this hotel. So this tactile quality of this stone is what's really shaping this hotel. So while it might seem to be Mesoamerican, Japanese, all these different characters in terms of the actual design, in terms of the tactile quality and the actual experience, would have a very different or regional character. So just to give you a little bit more about this whole hotel and how it does become interesting, really as a history of Japan itself modernizing. If we look carefully at this photograph, where that green arrow is, that's where the Rokumeikan was, that Western pavilion. It was destroyed in 1940, so most people have no recollection of that. But it was, in essence, the first Imperial Hotel. The same clients, same move to westernize. And so we can see that was located actually right here, where that orange arrow is pointing is where this was. And then the Imperial Hotel is just above that. So this is the original site part. You can see the moats around the Imperial Palace. But as Japan is evolving, this whole urban context is also transforming. So these moats are filled in. So we can see that same site where the Imperial Hotel is, but with these moats filled in. Actually, the first Imperial Hotel is located right here, and that's facing onto this moat to the north. Most people have no idea about that. When you see this model, the first Imperial that was next to it, because this street has disappeared, or that moat has disappeared, it's where the Marunouchi subway line runs. And if you go today, this is what you will see. You would have no idea that this was located here. So how much Japan has changed in this whole period. So the imperial throne, the emperor going from being a divine being before World War II to being a commoner after World War II, the whole rise in the economy, all of this is shaping the imperial hotel's context, especially in the post-war period. So in the post-war period, well actually it's taken over by the occupation forces, and one of the generals thinks it's a good idea to paint all of that oil stone white. It would be much brighter. Also with the subway line going past it, it is sustaining damage with all of that rolling, and it is not kept up. Here are some pictures from the 50s, 60s that start to show how the stone had grayed, not quite as much the center of being the new future of Tokyo, but this kind of character with the lanterns, the chairs, and as we see here, how much the context around it had really been built up with much higher rise buildings and the electrification and, as I mentioned, but other colors that come into it. And an annex that's built behind, that's torn down, and another annex is built in the World War II. Also, the south wing, it does suffer damage. There is talk as early as the late 1930s to demolish the Imperial Hotel with the 1940 Tokyo Olympics. That's never realized, but the 1964 Tokyo Olympics do become an impetus to tear down this lower rise hotel with the lack of hotel rooms. And there is actually a big movement to preserve the hotel. As we see here, it doesn't, it isn't successful. It's successful for saving it for the 1964 Olympics, but the 1970 Osaka Expo is the nail in the coffin. In order to have a high-rise hotel, torn down in 1967, as we see here. This is the fate that the hotel has. There have been photographs taken just right before it was torn down. So I think in saving Ellis, that's how one of the windows and a textile block and maybe a chair is saved. At least Jack Queen told me that it's somewhere around here. When we look at the contemporary hotel, you would have no idea how you can go to the hotel and go to the old Imperial Bar and get the Mount Fuji drink and eat the mural from the you have one fireplace that preserves it. And if you look at the carpet, maybe you can see a little bit of light. I don't know if it's very good. But that's what the status of the hotel is today. There are some other works of Frederick Wright that do still exist and become interesting counterpoints to the hotel and question to Japanese versus Western, the kind of hybrid nature of them. This is the Yamamura House in Kobe that on the outside has more of those Mesoamerican details perhaps. On the inside, you can see it being very Japanese with tatami mats. So how that actually plays out and really living in that space becomes very interesting. You know, it does have an affinity to the Hollyhock House in terms of the detailing, but rather than the tatami mats on the inside, we do see the screens. And so how that plays out in that context. In the Yamamura House, what's interesting is as the house steps down, you can see here's the tatami room, here's the room with chairs. When you're sitting on the tatami, you'll be basically at the same height as when you're in the chairs. So there's a dialogue between the Japanese sitting and the Western sitting through this configuration of the floor heights. And how the Imperial Hotel, in its expression of Japan with these very prominent roofs, could be seen to be expressed in Japanese designs from the 1930s. This is the Kyoto City Museum that's known for being representative of the Teikan Yoshiki, the imperial crown style. So that this becomes a symbol of Japanese-ness during this very contentious political period. Or other architects who worked with Wright designing their own houses. This is the Kaji House outside of Tokyo that has the right language, but in a different scale, perhaps, different composition. So the domestic interpretation of that becomes interesting, and one that actually is being preserved and actively looking to support and looking to the Martin House as an example of how to really sustain the house itself, but also the understanding in its context. And so this is my friend who's actively trying to save this house. Very interesting details. Here you can see some prefabricated houses that have this Wrightian character. So seeing right on the mass scale, whether it has reminiscences more of the prairie period, Yellow Park, or in Illinois, become a point of discussion. But it's interesting to see in this whole course of Wright's career, the American system built houses that do evoke some of the principles of Japanese dwellings in terms of wood frame that you could replicate and extend. The depiction of this almost like a Japanese print, and even the red mark, like again the stamp. So while it's seen as the American system built house, one can also see it within this Japanese lens. So this ambiguity that we can see even here with Gardner's Cottage. And so how we see many different sides coming back, interpreted in many different ways, and how in this space, I think it becomes extremely interesting to reflect back with the design of Toshiko Mori, who has inherited the design principles and legacies and inspirations of Wright in Japan and back, but in a contemporary idiom. And so how this dialogue can work in many different ways. And so the question is, what's Japanese, what's Western? How do you experience it? The importance of context have all complex implications. And how we can really understand it here, but first and foremost, the importance of the site, that we understand this neighborhood, we understand the context of that. And so it's really been an incredible joy to come here to understand that, to bring it alive in my mind, as through this research on the Imperial Hotel, I try to also bring back what it might have actually been, but not necessarily as it is in its transformed state, but in its potential as we look to inspirations around the world, but the importance of keeping it alive and how it connects to the community that loves it so much. Thank you very much. So it's a very interesting question. I mean, it is first on supported or connected with the Imperial family, but there are entrepreneurs. Shibasawa Eichi is one of the great entrepreneurs in the Meiji period who finances part of this. He's also financing the Bokumeikan, the other building that I mentioned, and the Hotel Okura. But Hayashi, that man I showed you at Taliesin, is a general manager who officially gives Wright the contract for the commission. But it's that relationship that becomes very important, but it is really on many different levels.
He was the general manager of what?
Of the hotel.
So he wasn't there representing the imperial government.
Not the imperial government, but Hayashi also earlier on is dealing in Japanese art in New York. He's a very international person. He disappears from the scene later on, but there are a number of different figures that play into this. Which, if you read the letters, become very interesting.
So you didn't show the peacock room?
I showed it in plan. It's right at the top. I was kind of going quickly, I'm sorry, but it is as you go up, you go at the very top. And actually, this here is the peacock room.
Okay.
So you can see part of the peacock.
Where?
Here.
This oh.
I know it's not really legible here, but.
So what was the function of the peacock?
It's a banqueting hall.
So how big was it?
It's quite large. I mean, it's larger than this room, but. In this cruciform plan, I don't know the exact square meter, but it was large, very large. And below that is a whole auditorium, and like I started to talk about, it's a whole city within the city, so it's the start of the hotel arcade, and so the shops that are there are very prominent.
So Wright is known for cost overruns, definitely on the Martin House. I'm curious about what he started by saying this cost and what it ended up costing him.
So obviously it was very expensive. And, I think that's part of not returning after 1922 in addition to a print scandal. because with this electrification, it's saving it in the earthquake, but it's extremely expensive, and so there were tremendous cost overruns. If you look at the correspondence, there's discussion about that, and so that was definitely causing problems with the client, but in the end, it's saving it, but at the time, it's obviously very expensive to maintain, and so cost is not necessarily his concern.
Did Wright specify the electrification?
He did early on, but it's in collaboration or in discussion with Hayashi, the manager, and it is seen as making it a cutting-edge hotel. but it's very different at that time.
Do you have any thoughts on the girls' school that he designed in Tokyo?
It's very interesting that you got in, and the free, it's sponsored by, as you may know, the magazine publisher of, it's Shizumotomo for Japanese housewives, and it's intent to have free spirit, and is on a much smaller scale from the Imperial Hotel, but in a similar configuration of forming the courtyard, and really interestingly scaled to children, rather than this much grander hotel with a banqueting hall and so forth. It's wood frame rather than the Oya stone and these floating piers, so the actual construction is quite different. But it still does exist on its original site. Around it is very different. But we actually had an SH final banquet in that space, and it was incredible.
Was it true that he spent almost his entire commission on Japanese art? It was like equivalent to like two or three train cars that he shipped it there?
I mean, I really haven't looked carefully at all the receipts and the sheer amount, but I do think that's true, the sheer number and amount of money, but also the amount of money that he made from selling the prints. And again, the scandal that I alluded to, that some of you might know, at least two of each, the Japanese art curator at the Metropolitan Museum curated an exhibition that talked about Frankfurt's other passion of the prints and how he was touching them up to be brighter for the Western eyes. And when that was revealed, his reputation as a dealer. And so that, again, was all happening about 1922. But I find it very interesting. Even though he doesn't return, lessons learned and his passion still does continue in this dialogue with Japan. But he never does see the imperial in the post-war period and all of this.
Just to follow up, you know, when you think of those, that time when he was, I didn't realize he spent so much time in Japan, in your chart, and he was traveling by steamliner. So the trip, his entire trip from Wisconsin out to Japan, one way must have been weeks and weeks, months, I think.
Several weeks, I think.
Each way, and I'm fascinated to think how much time he was spending in that trip each way, what was going on in his mind, because in one direction he's going east, and then everything happens to his experiences there, and then he comes back. It must have been...
Absolutely. I mean, you know, he's stopping off in L.A., there's a Hollyhock House, and he has other projects there. Sometimes he's going through Seattle, sometimes he's going through San Francisco, but it's... It is a long journey, but he's very enterprising in these stops and doing things. And so it would be very interesting to look more at what he's really doing on these ships. But a lot of letters talking about how he's sick and other things. And you know, they're all scandals that are happening this time, so he's escaping in a mental sense.
On that note, I'd like to thank our speaker. I think we've learned so much, just kind of this layered look at Wright's career, this kind of back and forth integration between East and West. What is it? When do they come together? And I know I'm even more intrigued to go to the show in New York City. And I welcome you again to our next lecture in August, September, and October. So please, round of applause for